Hello, well, I'm aware this is the last session before lunch, so we'll all try to gallop, myself included, even though I don't have the main task here. I was so delighted to be invited to chair this session, which I'm very excited to hear. The session's called Fleeting and Fragmentary, Things Fall Apart. We have just under an hour now. We're going to start with a paper by Amy de la Haye. Now I'm going to read the two CVs just for your information, so to get everything right. So Amy, who I work with very closely, so I really shouldn't be reading it, it's just for, you know, nerves' sake. Professor Amy de la Haye is Rootstein Hopkins Chair of Dress, History and Curatorship at LCF, and Joint Director, in fact with myself, the Research Centre for Fashion Curation. We've got a few images here. She's a dress historian and curator who's worked continuously in museums for almost 30 years, unbelievably, alongside teaching and writing. From 1991 to 1999, she was curator of 20th century dress at the V&A, where she curated the Street Style exhibition in 1994, which ignited her interest in worn and perished dress. More recently, her work on the Messel family dress collection at Brighton Museum and the film The Violet Hour, which is the part of the series shown yesterday, I believe, explores this preoccupation. Her work is united by an emphasis upon exploring objects to evoke or tell stories of lived, which she'll speak about. She's also interested in immateriality, the garments that are not represented within museum collections, and how these might be evoked in museum spaces. She's currently working on the artist Gluck's dress collection at Brighton Museum for an exhibition that will open in November 2017. So her paper is going to be followed by our esteemed guest, Professor Carolyn Steedman, who's emeritus professor at the University of Warwick in the History Department. Her most recent book, An Everyday Life of the English Working Class, was published in December 2013. In her CV that she sent for our small leaflet for this discussion in mind, she notes it had a lot to do with the stockings made by the framework knitter on whose diaries it is based. In Labour's Lost, Domestic Service and the Making of Modern England of 2009, she discussed stays as part of the wage system in 18th century households. And I believe she's going to speak more about stays this afternoon. She's currently working on a book, Poetry for Historians, not Poems for Historians, but a discussion of the kind of writing history is. She suggests poetry and everyday writing are material things. What she didn't mention in her CV was her book Dust, that I'm sure hovers in many of our colleagues' minds today. She says in Dust that history is a form of writing that celebrates constraints, and I believe this is something that she has profoundly in common with Amy de la Haye, who is also celebrating constraints, and this kind of constraints of exhibity that the kind of poetry of frailty inspires. Anyway, I look forward to their talks. Amy.
Thank you. This lecture's exceptional for me because, without exception, I call all my lectures objects of a passion, whatever the subject. And it's taken from an observation by Jean Baudrillard, who wrote in 1994 that, and I quote, "It ought to be obvious that the objects that occupy our daily lives are in fact the objects of a passion." However, my fascination also extends to beyond the point at which dress forms part of our daily lives, to the moment when, divested of its original function to be worn, it enters the context of the museum, where it serves new use values and new meanings. The point at which it becomes defined as an object, where its primary function is no longer to be worn, it's no longer an object of consumption, its role is primarily one to be interpreted. And there's a very clear trajectory in my own research, which, whatever the outcome, I mean, whether I'm teaching, I'm writing, or I'm curating, my work starts with objects. And some of us have talked about, do we go looking for something, And I think I don't go looking for anything. I start with an object that interests me, or in the case of this project, thousands of photographs, and I see where they take me. So this is an archive of extraordinary photographs of the Worth Fashion House, held at the Archive of Art and Design. And then this is my book, Worth, a portrait of an archive. I'm not only interested in fashion, I'm really interested in dress, and particularly dress as evidence of lives lived, of women's lives lived in particular. And I became, first of all, obsessed with a pair of Land Army breeches and was going to do one exhibition called Exploding an Object that turned into an exhibition about the Land Girls, who still, it's not a pejorative term, they still self-define as Land Girls, they still meet as Land Girls. And I felt very strongly that often when we take oral testimonies, we talk about people's past lives, but these are women living today with very present lives, and they still self-define as Land Girls. So I wanted them to be very present in my exhibition, even in their makeshift uniforms, because after the war they had to give their uniforms back. And every exhibition I curate, I think I have two preoccupations. One is the subject, and the second is how I'm going to, what my curatorial intervention into that subject is. And in terms of the Land Army exhibition, I wanted to look at multiples, mass production. Should we exhibit objects that are mass-produced in the same way that we exhibit single items, because museums tend to privilege singularity. In the case of dress, if we're looking at an haute couture garment, that's probably entirely appropriate. But if we're looking at a pair of breeches that were produced in their tens of thousands, should we exhibit them in the same way? So I devised, this was at Brighton Museum for an exhibition in 2009, my wall of breeches, which had statements saying there were so many Land Girls, there were so many pairs of breeches produced, and then also to explore immateriality, absent objects, and to consider why, of course, it's the smallest objects that always survive because they can't be altered, and to consider the fact that average-sized garments tend to get worn more. And so I just had these sort of, we made a graded pattern one side up and looked at ghostly silhouettes. And then Clara Button, my book, it's one of two books that I wrote for children that are material culture narratives based on objects in the V&A. And so Clara's a very old-fashioned little girl, illustrated by Emily Sutton, whose grandmother was a milliner, but she never met her. And she goes on a whole journey in the V&A. And so this is, it's actually not an especially beautiful hat, but it's the hat. And there's the hat in the museum store as Emily saw it and drew it. There's Clara Button and the Magical Hat Day, and she's flying through the galaxy of hats, which I called a millenarium. So there's a very clear link between objects and research outcomes. Now, recently my interest has been taken a stage further. I've been interested in clothes that have been worn, but increasingly I'm becoming in clothes that are at the point where they're beyond even exhibiting. So they've been worn or not worn, and they're virtually perished, or we could describe them as dead. Now, this is part of an ongoing preoccupation, I realised, which partly started when I curated with colleagues, including Carol Tullock, who's here today, the Street Style exhibition at the V&A in 1994, which extraordinarily is a very long time ago. And so even as curator of 20th century dress at the V&A, where my remit was about design that leads, and it was about exhibiting, interpreting clothes that were as the designer expressed, they were pristine from the designer's studio, I started thinking, well, in this context, subcultures also lead, and set about acquiring 150 head-to-toe outfits of people who self-defined as the clothes they wore with a particular subculture. And so, this caused all sorts of debates in the museum. The whole museum got involved. You know, we were dealing with people with assumed names that didn't have bank accounts, that didn't have telephones. So it was a wonderful sort of inclusive project. But for the purpose of this paper, one of the questions that came out of it was that I was bringing these garments that were absolutely filthy into the museum. And that's not what you did at the V&A. And so we started, there was all sorts of debates. You know, if we, there's no question that we're going to take the grease out of the rockers' jackets, and there's no way I'm going to take the mud off the traveller's boots, because it is clearly part of the authenticity and the integrity of that object. Now, if we're not going to take the dirt out of the traveller's boots, and this two travellers and their little girl, Fraggle and her partner, who were protesting in the Forest of Dean against motorway developments. If we leave the dirt on their clothes and on their boots, why do we so routinely remove it from the 18th century dress? So that prompted a conference at the Museum of Mankind, which posed the question, sacred dirt, question mark. So moving on to another project, in 2005, working with Lou Taylor and Eleanor Thompson, who was the curator at Brighton Museum, we brought together some clothes that had belonged to six generations of one family, which outside of royalty is possibly unique. And it's the Messel, Ross, Sanborn families. And across museums in Sussex primarily, but also in Ireland and in various family homes, there were some 500 garments dating from the 1870s to 2004. Some of them had been worn by multiple women in generations, long before vintage clothing was fashionable, and throughout the generations, the women customised their clothing. And today it's quite hard to do something which is radical in fashion terms, but if we were to go to Alexander McQueen and then alter what they did and sew something of our own on it, it would be quite daring. And that's exactly what these women were doing. There's a particular point at which people give things to museums, and it's often in part of the preparation for death. And so this is Anne, Countess of Ross, in her early 20s. She's an absolute society beauty. Her brother is the foremost theatrical costumier and set designer, Oliver Messel. And this is Anne as Countess of Ross, who lives at Burr Castle that Grace talked about yesterday, with Lord Ross. So when she's 79, she starts a process whereby she starts presenting clothes to the museum. Now, giving away clothes is always a wrench, because they are so entwined with our person. But what was extraordinary about Anne was that even from her early 20s, she preserved examples of her own and her family's clothing, much of which came from top London dressmakers. And she kept items that were not only in pristine condition, but also items that were falling apart. To her, they were examples of design, but perhaps more importantly, she considered them as holders of deeply personal family meaning. And one of the most poignant moments was when we started going through these boxes, looking at all these objects, is the lipstick trace that I find on the sort of strip of silk bound with pearls. It's a medieval style silk wedding dress. The family always go for historical styles. And it's got a lipstick trace. And it was that same issue. You know, we would normally remove the lipstick because it will eat into the silk, but it was so intensely human. And I always joke, we just hope it wasn't the curator's lipstick. And then when I said this in Edinburgh, and Becky, who was the curator at the time, she came up to me and said, no, it wasn't my lipstick. So Anne kept the clothes in various family homes, and she kept them in museums. Now, increasingly, I think I've become more and more aware that museum objects that show their age and are marked by human usage can be particularly moving. And of course, I would argue that dress perhaps more than many other media. Clothes don't smash and become instantly ruined. Instead, they disintegrate gradually with the passage of time. And that's a process that we could perhaps also liken to human vulnerability. We also alter the properties of the clothes we wear. They can, over time, come to echo our own body shapes. They carry stains and they retain smells, human and synthetic. And as such, they can so effectively evidence lives lived. And certainly, I mean, being a dress curator, I'm all too aware of this, they're the hardest possessions of all to part with when someone we loved has died. Now, Anne kept the clothes in various positions. Some in perhaps she chose to keep in family homes, others she lent to the museum, and she had different strategies for what she did with them. Now, once she gave the clothes to Brighton Museum, she started bombarding the museum director with letters saying, these clothes must never be exhibited in the context of the designer. I only ever want them to be exhibited in the context of my family. Mm-hmm. And then the next batch of letters starts saying, you mustn't conserve them. You must never sew them with synthetic threads. And she writes, this is in 1981, and I quote, "Their frailty is in itself their magic, don't you think?" So Anne felt really, really strongly that the clothes should be kept together, whether they were in the box, whether they were displayed. And this is her mother's going away dress, Maud's going away dress, which is completely shattered, and the hat from 1898. Now, when Lou Taylor wanted to display Maud's hat, but was unable to display the dress because it was falling to bits, Anne demanded the entire outfit back. The outfit triggered memories of her mother, and in turn it triggered memories of her mother's absence. This is Bell Castle that Grace talked about yesterday. And this is, my students have heard this lots of times, but this is my most magic ever curatorial moment. Lou, Eleanor and I go to Bell Castle. The gardens are open to public, but the castle isn't because they live in it. We go up the tower, and this is what we see. Boxes, 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 they're labelled. Even the labels are wonderful because over the years the women have changed, they've made notes, it's Le Coq Noir, Charles James, amazing sculptural black dress, about what's in these boxes. And then we open this box. And on top of a bottle green wool crepe dress with an ornate neckline is a note. And the note reads, and I quote, "Had a wonderful time in this dress, I'm ashamed to say." Full stop. 1941 exclamation mark, exclamation mark. So the styling and the materiality and the word in Jacques Martin label tell us much, but it's the handwritten note that really arouses our curiosity. We become intrigued to learn more about the biography of this garment and its wearer. Where was it worn and what sort of wonderful time was had wearing it in the midst of war? And its significance also as a holder of memory. Why was it kept? And why did Anne add this note, which hints at so much but tells so little, and it was so clearly written for other eyes? Now, the museologist, Gaynor Kavanagh, whose book is my Bible, she's observed that, and I quote, "However defined or categorized, the transference of emotions and memory onto the concreteness of the object separates that object from the run of the mill and appears to invest it with something almost magical." Now, it wasn't only old clothes that Anne kept that were virtually perished, also quite recent ones. This is a Peter Russell dress from the early 1930s. And we decided to exhibit this anyway. And so, although the viewer is denied any sense of the garment styling, its perspective or relationship with the body, I would argue that garments that have gradually disintegrated over the passage of time can also be hauntingly beautiful. And we decided to exhibit it thus. Once we'd made this decision, Lou found another one of Anne's letters, and we were very pleased because we thought she'd probably approve of this intervention. And she wrote, "All period dresses, if they have that meaning of being worn, if only once become frail, think what Mary Queen of Scots' beheading dress would be like. It would have meaning." And in the same way that there are trends in fashion, there are also trends in academia and in museums, and there are other exhibitions which have started to engage with this, one of which was called Tattered and Torn, which was exhibited at the Empire Historic Arts Centre at Governors Island in New York in 2012, which comprised 13 vignettes. They were said to be deaccessioned garments, but it's also entirely likely they were sold garments. And whereas lots of museums engage with, or for photographers, with extreme contrast, the peeling layers of paint are clearly meant to sort of echo the dissembled garments. And then I'm a bit running out of time, so some of you saw the film The Violet Hour yesterday. I'm not going to show it now, but I also wanted to reinstate those garments that are always overlooked. A seemingly prosaic tea gown from circa 1948, the sweat stains, is in the Bright Museum collection. It's without provenance, we have no documentation for it. It's given a temporary museum number, and taking it to extremes, we could liken it to sort of the lost soldier. And Katerina Afanasopoulou, who's also a UAL member of staff, made this really beautiful, poignant film looking at the tea gown and then transposing layers of sort of bomb-crated earth onto it. And then I'd just like to finish by talking about current projects and current preoccupations, which, with colleagues at the Centre for Fashion Curation, including Jeff Horsley, who coordinated the student exhibitions here and the beautiful brochure, we're working on a funding bid called the Perished Dress Project, where we're going to try and consider garments like this, which are all too often regarded as a problem and perhaps don't get seen very often, we're going to try and explore what they can do rather than what they can't do. They can't be shown on mannequins, but what other stories can we tell? Some of them, of course, are hauntingly beautiful and have a sort of McQueen-esque appeal, but they don't all have that. I want to know more about shattered silk, because a lot of shattered silk from the late 18th and early 19th century, it shatters even when it's cared for really, really carefully. So what once were garments that came into the museum collections that were in really very fine condition now look like this. And it's because the silk was woven with various salts made from iron, lead or tin that were bonded to the fibres during the manufacturing process. And they added a wonderful pearly lustre to Edwardian dress. They gave it the desired sort of frou-frou sound that like writers like Zola have evoked. But most significantly, they added weight, and silk was sold by the weight, so they added value. But over time, the metal cuts literally razor-like into the silk, and that's why we get these like parallel lines of distressed silk. So we've been thinking about various strategies of how we might exhibit, interpret these clothes. And Jeff found Longvin's advertising campaign, whereby a mannequin is laid flat and reflected in a mirror. And this strategy was taken sort of into the museum in the Longvin exhibition at Palais Galliera. And to start with, we were quite inspired by this process whereby the dress is laid flat and you see it reflected in the mirror. But actually, you end up looking at upside down garments and foreshortened garments. I'm not criticising it because I think it's an inspiring and new way of exhibiting garments. It's not the one we want to do, but we're going to explore different strategies that might work well. This is another image. And also to make the point that it's not all historical dress that's perished. Quite often it's new garments made from plastics, made from rubber. Judy showed this garment to Jeff at the CSM archive. It's an Alexander McQueen. It's a prototype for a jacket. And it's got sellotaped onto it the paper pattern pieces where they want the pattern on the jacket. And it's really, really fragile. And again, has a very particular kind of history to tell. And we will try and exhibit it in a way that honours the garment, and at all times, you know, we have to balance care and access, but we want to keep the garment stable as long as we don't damage any further. And then these are shoes in the Cordwainers Historic Archive, which so many museums either wouldn't have kept or would never have collected. And I became obsessed with the one in the middle, which repulsed my colleague, and I wrote about for the archives book, which I think you've all been given a copy. So it's a boot that's been handed down through the generations, not through the generations, from lady to servant. It's been cut open to accommodate a bunion or something. But that's a shoe that evidences lives lived. So we don't only want to look at fashion, we want to look at all sorts of clothes and work with colleagues who work in museums, all sorts of museums, very much like the sort of museums that Fiona was talking about. Museums that might, for instance, have a fishing jersey that's completely falling to bits, or, for example, the museum of folklore run by Simon Costin, which might have an outfit like the straw outfit, which might start, you know, there's going to be a limit to how long it can be on display. And so, to conclude, I'm with Gaynor Kavanagh, my favourite. She writes, "Without a feeling for people's lives and histories, museums become remote and irrelevant. And so, I would argue imaginative narratives and exhibition installations of worn or even perished dress can clearly address this. And I really hope the HLF agree. And that these wonderful, wonderful garments aren't destined to remain in tissue. Thank you."
I would thank all of you, but it would take time, and time is what I don't have. It's in my heart, okay? At the moment, it looks as if, at last, curators and other museum staff have taken some notice of costume and social historians and what they've been saying about stays these 20 years past. Now, stays were, in the 18th century, what would later be known as corsets. Pair of stays was common usage because they were often constructed in two halves to be laced at the front and at the back. All women wore stays. All women, high and low. What foreign observers of Britain noticed in the 18th century was that the cityscape was quite different in Britain compared with the with Europe, the rest of Europe. Bodies passing on the street, all of them, duchess and drab, were shaped by a pair of stays. Now, the stays that have survived from the 18th century, and you can find now in an instant, just Google images, 18th century stays, are the most extraordinarily beautiful objects, but they belonged to elite women. Here we have the Woman's Hour presenter, Jane Garvey, at the V&A exhibition, undressed, contemplating that extraordinarily rare item, a pair of working woman's stays. And she's talking to the exhibition curator, Edwina Ehrman. Now, it's not just rare for that particular exhibition, but just simply rare. The curator knows that even a woman applying to the parish for poor relief was likely to be provided with a pair of stays, along with petticoats, bodice, and a good pair of work boots. Now, the curator thinks that this was because stays were somehow connected to the idea of moral rectitude. So not all the lessons of a historian like Lynn Sorge have actually been absorbed. We should look at the stout pair of work boots that a parish might provide to get a woman worker off the rates out doing road work or field work, finding her work as a cheap domestic servant. Stays were workwear for working women. That's the kind of object I'm talking about. The precise nature of their materiality and their immateriality, why the toughest of all garments is fragmentary to the historical imagination. And I'm talking about a historical imagination. That too, for a historical imagination is what we have to have in thinking about things like this from the past. For the poorer sort, they were workwear. All these women workers were wearing their stays. The poor little maid sweeping into eternity in the pages of a book for children is wearing her stays. Stays were to do with the servant's labor. And employers knew this very well. Her ability, the maid's ability to work well. Now, my little young housemaid, take care to be up early in the morning. Lace your stays and pin your things on very well tight around you, or you never can work well. As you can see, Hannah Glass advising, actually not the 13-year-old, but her mistress in 1760. This child maid doing something rather dangerous with a candle and a baby is wearing her stays. The young woman gathering cranberries for market in West Yorkshire, 1816, is wearing her stays, and so is her companion, the older woman on the right. Stays were part of the wage economy in many middling sort households. In in Slathwaite, oh, let's go back to that, in Slathwaite, which is between Huddersfield and Halifax, the Reverend John Murgatroyd noted in May 1790 that his neighbour and her two promising daughters walked to Huddersfield today. Our servant Phoebe goes with them to buy stays, etc. 18 months later, they needed mending. On his shopping list for a trip to Halifax were some leather for to mend her stays. Phoebe Beatson was in an excellent place. 14 miles away, up the Pennine Ridge, at Pondon Mill near Howarth, there's a whole Wuthering's Heights story here, which I can't tell you, Worcester manufacturer Robert Heaton recorded in very great detail the buckles, buttons, hats, hat boxes, lengths of cloth, laces and stays bought on his credit by the young women who worked as the Heaton family servants between 1768 and 1794. In these accounts, 30 female servants, they came and went like crazy, all right, they weren't all there together, only two of them at a time. 30 female servants' acquisitions were recorded. Stays, new or second hand, were acquired by 15 of them. New ones were expensive, ranging in price from 18 shillings to £1, 4 shillings and sixpence, and a new painted silk gown only put 17 shillings and sixpence on the Heaton's tally sheet in 1792. A new pair of stays was the 18th century equivalent of buying your old pair a small used car, because the average cash wage for a female servant in the Pennine region at the end of the 19th century was £3, 10 shillings a year. So for employers like the Heatons, stays were taken for granted of the domestic service economy. They really do not belong, though, to the same category as the painted gowns and black silk hats that the Pondon Hall young women got. They, I have always assumed, wanted a pair of stays for reasons of practicality and comfort. Of course, they were also the foundation upon which you could fashion a contemporary sexiness. Skirt and bodices and petticoats were pinned onto a firm foundation, but they were underwear in the most important sense, particularly in the way they provided an extra layer of warmth around the middle body area. And they did not get really dirty, for they were almost universally worn over a shift. They could be altered in length and width, professionally or by their owner. Women could make their own from some stout canvas and half a dozen split reeds. They were handed, they were handed down to daughters and granddaughters and sold on to the second hand market. Really, you have to think that stays cannot have restricted movement or breathing or effort very much, if at all. Obviously, if you can lace tight, you can lace loose. They fitted as well or as badly as the brassieres that a majority of modern British women report as uncomfortable and that professionals say are ill-fitting. From the 1780s onwards, stays may actually have increased in comfort with the introduction of cutting on the bias, gauze, darts, flares, and what were called as slopes, sewing on the slope. Even the straight up and down stays of the earlier century, no shaping, no darting, actually held the breasts in place, stop them bouncing around as you worked, and perhaps prevented that irritating band of sweat that develops beneath the breasts and that is now absorbed by the bra, whether it's wired or not. No wonder Hannah Glass associated stays with working hard and well. And really, if we look back through the Victorian fog of tight lacing and fetishism, look back through the prism of 19th century corset erotics, we will never find meaning in Hannah Glass's instructions to her little housemaid, and we will never understand the new and second-hand ones in the wage economy of Pondon Hall. But survival of these tough and durable items of workwear, or underwear, call them what you like, is extraordinarily rare. You will find them in fragments of account books, or, if you're more than lucky, as at the beginning, in an old house in Whitby. Whitby, by the way, was a minor but important centre of the East Coast whaling industry. The last stages of whalebone processing took place on shore and at the docks, all up and down the coast from Hull to Aberdeen. Perhaps this is just a guess, the particularly tank-like construction of the pair that Jane Garvey was looking at, the ones found in Whitby, may be related to the proximity about their construction from material like this. I've got a better image, in which the ladies of Hartlingfordbury, Hertfordshire, advised on making wearing apparel for any ladies' poorer neighbours. This book provides three patterns at the end, fold-out pages which you detached and cut around, three for stays. The one for young girls, which is the page here, suggests using duck, which was a strong linen, lighter than canvas, cane split once, not whalebone, cane split once, and buying, purchasing coloured laces to finish them. They are cut with darts and gusset, so they're bang up to the minute in design for 1789. How long would they last? Not a century and a half, like the Whitby one described. Maybe 50 years. Handed down to younger sisters, widened professionally in 1800 for a bigger girl, saved for a daughter, mended 20 times over before they finally wore out. Their value on the second-hand market would not be great, for there was no whalebone to extract and sell on. Their value would have been as cotton or linen or worsted rags. And rags did have some value. The handful that this pair of stays would have produced in, say, 1830 was worth perhaps the price of two loaves of bread. Now, talking fleeting and fragmentary, the rag market, where this pair of stays may have ended up, is a thing to pursue. Not here, not now, but if I were doing this all over again, which I'm not, I would start at one end with Beverly Lemire's book, Fashion's Favourite, that was 1992, and is about the market in cotton and secondhand cotton. And I would have Karl Marx's observations about the rag-picking trades in the first volume of Capital at the other end of my revised piece. All our evidence is fragmentary, whether it be a thing or a text. In this kind of fragmentary history, a scurrilous popular song is worth as much as the Heaton's account book. During the era of counter-revolution in Britain, after Tom Paine had published The Rights of Man in 1791, and before he was tried in absentia and convicted of seditious libel, he was sneered at in dozens of scurrilous and satiric ballads for daring to be a staymaker's son with something to say about the Constitution. As this one claims, he had turned from moulding forms and bolstering shapes to shaping laws, sir. And it's to be sung to the tune of Bow Wow Wow. So I add class condescension to my little heap of historical fragments. Pages from an account book, a clergyman's diary, a pattern book, a book for children, a self-help book for women who want to know how to get the most and best kind of labour out of a 13-year-old maidservant. With the one material trace I've talked about here, the one surviving pair of stays, I have tracked them down. I think we should stand with Jane Garvey and Edwina Ehrman in the V&A, feel their terrible poignancy, shed a tear. I think actually if you go to bbc.co.uk and listen, you can hear that they are actually crying in a restrained Radio 4 kind of way. And we should look at the brown staining, as Ehrman tells us. Look at that most material trace, the wearer's sweat. For what we are looking at here is labour. We are looking at a labour relationship, at labour expended, at labour bought and sold, sometimes for cash, sometimes for a pair of scarlet laces or some secondhand stays. And really, I should not end with Karl Marx. I should begin with him in his early, much earlier, extraordinary thinking about the most fragmented and most material aspect of the human body. I should go back to the earlier Marx, the Marx of the 1840s, before he decided that labour didn't really exist, or that labour only existed in its moment of realisation in a commodity like this, or a thing that could be sold on the market. Back then, I ought to go to begin again, to read the sweat stains, back to the time when, for Marx, labour really did have a real shape, a real quiddity in the world, when it was, for him, this peculiar commodity, which has no other repository than human flesh and blood. Now, all the bodies that laboured in this pair of stays are gone to dust, but the sweat remains over 200 years.
On. Yes, Oriana has said that we can go over slightly, but I am aware of everybody's hunger, and therefore it may be that you want to ask Amy and Carolyn some questions over lunch. But if anybody has a burning question that might spark a short debate, please feel free to quickly do so. I think they were both incredibly powerful presentations and raise so many issues.
I'd love to thank you both for your presentations. They were fascinating, and I was just wondering whether with both of your presentations you could link that back to Fiona's paper as well, in terms of the notion of the sort of partiality of relationship of curatorial projects to objects, and the way in which we get so used to thinking of the things that the Countess Ross didn't want to happen, that you see clothing in terms of someone's designing of it rather than someone's owning and wearing of it, which in two extremes of social hierarchy, you see the same kind of issues being raised, I think, in terms of you're looking at an item not through what it meant as a commodity, but what it meant in relation to a human being.
The breeches question, isn't it?
It is for
you. The whole point about the breeches was that they'd never been worn, and so all the breeches, I bought them all on eBay because it was cheaper than borrowing them. And the whole point about them was that I thought I was going to go and see lots of old ladies, and they were going to tell me about their breeches, but they'd all have to give them back after the war. So the breeches, in fact, had all been in storage in Europe. And suddenly they've got a commercial value because of the reenactment group, and because there are women up and down the country who dress head to toe in authentic Land Army clothes for wartime events, and because of the vintage market. So I had to tell different stories, and so they weren't stories about lives lived. So I looked at the biography of the garments from the cotton being picked, maybe in America, by land girls when historically it hadn't been white women who picked cotton, and then looked at them coming over on the ships and then being worn out, and then very poetically at the end I like to consider that they were ragged, and when they could no longer be used as rags, they were turned into shoddy and turned into fertilizer and returned to the land. So it was telling a different story. So yeah, I suppose when I was saying earlier, it's about where the object takes you, because that's not where I'd expected it to take me.
Because I think at the V&A, obviously your experience was so different, because it's about specialness in a different way, isn't it? It's about the unique, as opposed to the multiple.
Yes.
Translating your practice, I think, at that
point very powerfully. Yeah, and also, the ideal garment was the garment that I rang up Vivian Westwood and said, can I have those blue shoes that Naomi fell over, or can I have something? And that it was perfect. And when we acquired things, we had these boxes, and you ticked them. And one was basically, it's new, it's in perfect condition. And if it was anything less than that with regards to contemporary dress, you actually had to make a plea for the garment, because conservation's expensive. And you couldn't give space to a garment that you might not exhibit. But I suppose I've been saying all along, I'm an object-led curator, I'm interested in objects, but increasingly I think I'm interested in women's lives, and dress is the medium I use to tell those stories about women's lives. Unashamedly women.
And so you've hunted down stones.
Oh, I just but, on the internet.
Yes. But have you hunted them down in person?
No. I think that's the only pair of working women's stays in the country. And the museum in, what was it?
Bose Museum.
The Bose Museum, which has been lent to the V&A.
Yeah, and they've got an amazing dress.
And have you seen them at the V&A?
No.
Yeah. So you don't have a desire to encounter them,
no.
So to speak?
that's where you differ, perhaps. But that's where we want to put them together.
I mean, it would be like wanting to encounter the Cranberry Girl. I can't. You know, I've had little arguments with Amy about this. If I'm ever in Northumberland, I'll go and have a look, all right? But I'm not taking an enormously long train journey to go and look at a pair of stays that I know all I want to know about already, and that I can tell my historical narrative about without looking at them. I have the experience of the wearers, I have all these account books, I have all this instructional manual, I have...
That's exactly what this is about. But I mean, what do you think, given you can't wear them? I mean, I think that at the museum, I think why I asked the question is that because the museum frustrates touch. Mm. So the question is whether you would ever be allowed to touch them.
I wouldn't be allowed
to
touch them.
And if you were to be allowed to touch them, you'd have to touch them with gloves on.
Yes.
You know, you wouldn't be able to literally touch them, masked.
But you could
so
see them with your eyes.
But so, so that's why I ask whether, at what level do these frustrations exist in terms of removes? You know, whether touch is important, and whether sort of unfettered encounters matter when you can never be the person who wore them. What do you
well,
feel
I
is
I
your...
I might not be the person who wore them, and I have obeyed the golden rule that you don't try anything on under any circumstances. But I've been privileged, I've been allowed to touch on the whole. But there is nothing that beats the poignancy to me of looking at that object. And so it's a completely different starting point, because I couldn't not go to Bose. It's a pain. I've been there several times. It's an absolute pain to get to, but I have to see it. I have to be that close to it, even if I can't touch it.
But stays are not my story. I am not. They know that stays are incidental. It could be a pair of work boots to tell. I mean, they have particular intimacy, and they're very complex garments, and they involved more manufacturing process than any other item of 18th century dress, and that's you know, the filthy tanning trades, the worsted and linen weaving, the whalebone trades were disgusting. I mean, but I can't encounter the Whitby whaling trade, you know, to touch it. But I can read about it and understand what effect it had on the workers involved in it. And that's what makes the object. I'm removed from everything I write about. There are multiple degrees of separation. That's the condition of my being.
Why I disagree with you personally is not about it, but about you. Is that because reading your book on dust, you feel as though you are in that space.
Yes. Well, then I might be quite a good writer.
And so there's something deep. I'm sure you are, and I know you are. But the thing is that your writing is deeply, deeply experiential. That's why I'm pushing on your point, because you...
We ingest your dust.
You do feel dust. But these days, you're not very often allowed to touch the original documents. I wrote the whole of an everyday of the English working class for a photocopy of a photocopy because Nottinghamshire Archives would not let me until the very last days when the book was finished with the curator standing next to me. I was allowed to place my hand on the Morocco binding of Joseph Woolley's diaries and even to open the page. But I worked for, you know, a photocopy of a photocopy, a terrible photocopy made in the 1990s. However, in the old days, like 20 years ago, before everything was digitized, you know, the one thing you could be sure of feeling was dirt, especially in the National Archives, where all those boxes consist of decaying matter transferred from government departments, you know, 17th century, 18th century, decaying matter, stored in Whitehall for a century, then put uncleaned into boxes, transferred to the PRO at Chancery Lane and now at the Public Record Office in Kew. So you could do some fine biological analysis. I mean, that is often 1780s dirt. You could learn a lot from it, but it's not the sort of thing I want to learn. I mean, I'm interested in the dirt. Well, only in the people who had to remove dirt for their betters. But, so when I wrote Dust, we were in an era where you did actually feel dust in.
Yeah. I just felt
local record offices now. You don't feel it very much anymore because you're more and more is being digitized.
Would anyone like to contribute? Yes.
More and more is being cleaned, not just digitized.
I can't hear, sorry. Can someone put that?
More and more is being cleaned, not just digitized, and there seems to be a problem where there is this overzealousness of cleaning documents. I mean, you touched on this with the costume, how you had to kind of argue to keep these stains and keep the sweat stains. It's the same with documents. And, you know, I think conservators and archivists, curators need to work more together to find a solution, because there's a fear of researchers contaminating one document from another. And it's, but actually there is a deep history in the value perceived by the creators of those documents, of how they keep them even, how they store a whole collection. And if that's clean, the documentation of the condition of those materials is seen as of no importance to the researcher. It's like behind the scenes on a database that's accessible just to the staff. So yeah, I think it's people are becoming more growing aware, but it's a very difficult situation to know what to do, to be honest.
Several things about that. They're just practical material things. In county record offices now, 10 years ago, you used to be asked to wear white gloves. Now, discoveries have been made that actually the clean human hand is the best medium for moving parchment and rag-based paper. So hands, if you can get your hands on them, are considered the best thing. But I know what you mean about the integrity of a collection and that the dirt and debris is part of it. And I think that applies mainly to highly coherent, elite collections. It makes not a damn bit of difference that the poor law bastardy records from Clifton, Nottinghamshire, 1786, are clean or not. You know, they were put together by diverse hands. They were minor functionaries of the local state, tediously filling in forms, magistrates deciding whether to place an affiliation order on a young man. I mean, I think those, we're talking about very different kinds of collections and very different kinds of documents.
But I would say that one of the issues is the judgment made on that. Mm. So, for example, I went to a conference on record keeping in the early modern period, and someone gave a fascinating lecture on her, where she had seen evidence where documents had been cleaned, but actually to her research, it would have been vital to know what was happening there. How they were folded as well as the stains on them. Yes. And so we're in a position where we're making that decision willy-nilly, dare I say it, you know.
Yeah. No, I think any other questions we may need to ask over lunch, but I'd like to thank Amy and Carolyn for this.